Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise. Joyful, joyful. Father, we adore you. Lift your voice as we stand and sing together.
Lord God, we love you and we praise you. Our gift of worship is only in response to your gift of grace and what you have done for us in Jesus. Lord, we are so thankful we are here today. We're thankful we can worship you here in this place together and at home, wherever we are, to sing to you. We are joyful, joyful because of who you are and because of your great love for us. And now we give our hearts, all that we are, to you in this time of worship. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. You may be seated. It is so great to see you. Friends, it's been 203 days since we were here together. Yes. We're just overflowing with joy. And let me just say it from the start. We're not meant to worship and sing with masks on. Right? I mean, now you're doing that. If you've tried, I don't know if you tried that at the grocery store or wherever you've been. It's not easy. And yet it's what we're going to do for a while in these days to protect and really guard against any spreading of this virus. Our medical team has led us so well in these days. We're following their guidance, so we're masked up here on campus. But if you're joining us online, I want to speak to everyone. We have hundreds, thousands even over time joining us online. And we're grateful that you have joined us here. When you feel that it's appropriate and can, you come join us. Many of you are guests, and we want you to, even now, you can see that, so you can scan that QR code. You can do this in the room, by the way, if you want to grab your phone, not to look at anything else on your phone, but you can hit your photo. You can not even take a picture, just put it up on the QR code. Do that there at home. We've had many who've responded in the early hour who said they're watching, and that just lets us know how we can serve you and how we can contact you and pray for you. So if you're new, especially do that, all right? So hey, throughout the pandemic, our church family has stepped up to serve in so many ways. You know, we can worship God in song and worship together, but it's worshiping him with our lives and through service. And we've been able to help those who have been in need, those who are suffering through this time. So many are and have. And still are through this COVID-19 pandemic. And so we've shown you, if you've been watching us, how sandwich and clothing drives, supply drives, any kind of drive you can have, we've had it to help really bless our neighbors in our city and in our state. We've even blessed Jack Lowe Elementary. You may have heard this. We've adopted every single classroom at Jack Lowe Elementary, members of our church. And that's not just for now, but throughout the year. And we're going to continue to serve our partners. But we wanted you today to hear directly from them because they wanted to say thank you to our church family for all that we've done. So let's celebrate and let's watch this.
Hey, this is Ty Choice from the Men of Nehemiah. We've been able to keep our guys focused on the Word of God and keep our guys in recovery. We thank you for your partnership. We thank you for your prayers. And we ask that you would just continue to bless us, continue to pray for us as we pray for you. We love you guys. Thank you, Park City Baptist.
Thank you, Park City Baptist.
This is Wes Keys here, Executive Director of Brother Bill's Helping Hand. I want to take a moment to just say thank you. Thank you so much for the outpouring of love and generosity that we here at Brother Bill's have felt because of your church. We can't do this work alone. We have you as a partner. And because of that, we are blessed.
Hi, Park City's family. Greetings from the Treasures and Potter's House in Guatemala. We just want to thank you for your amazing generosity during the past few months. Most importantly, your support has provided God's love. And what an opportunity this has been to remind ourselves and them that God cares about us.
Thank you very much for your support. And we thank you, Park City's Baptist Church, for all you do in the Rio Grande Valley and the Colonia families. May the Lord bless you.
So we really appreciate you guys. Thank you so much for supporting For the Nations.
And because of you, we are able to help kids in the Richardson, Garland, and Dallas Independent School Districts.
Kids get to hear the gospel message every day, and they get to have a Bible story and learn about Jesus. And so we're thankful for the opportunity to keep doing that even during the pandemic.
Thank you so much to the members of Park City's Baptist Church for the many ways in which your church have partnered with us to minister to those in need during COVID-19.
Thank you, church family, for all that you have done. We're so thankful. Yeah, we can celebrate that, praising God for all that he's given to us. And we're able to share. It's just the way of Jesus. And our church is so generous. So thank you. We also need to continue to be generous for all that's now ramping up back here, right here within our church, and all that God is calling us to do this fall and into the new year. We're longing for a new year, right? And it's going to come, but we've got a lot to do now. You can give online right now. Many of you do that. You can do that even now. And if you brought your offering today, you can put that in one of the many offering boxes that you'll find across the church. So please stop by one of those. And do that. You can also mail your gift in if you need to do that. But thank you so much for your generosity. I want us to pray as we continue to worship the Lord. Lord, you are the fount of all blessing. You're the one where all of our great gifts come from. And so we just give back to you the very best you've given to us as an act of worship. And so we give you praise. We give you our lives. We set our hearts towards repentance, and with great joy we receive your grace as we prepare even today for the Lord's Supper. And so, Lord, we thank you that we can worship you today. We thank you for the generosity you've given to us in Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
The greatest reason we've come here today, ultimately, is to celebrate the grace that is ours through the gift of the Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, to grace, how great a debtor. We're no longer held accountable because of Christ. And so we sing, Come Thou Fount of every blessing with great joy. Tune my heart, straighten it toward you, Father, to sing your praise. Stand together, Come Thou Fount of every blessing.
Source of our blessing. And today we're going to talk about joy. How about that? Of all topics on this day, that joy is not dependent upon our circumstances. It's not like happiness. We'll talk through that today. But today is a special day in many ways. Tonight begins Yom Kippur for our Jewish friends. And it is a weekend many of us in churches like ours and across our nation have decided it's a time to stop and offer prayers of repentance to the Lord. Yom Kippur is a day of atonement. It's a day where we come before him in repentance and prayer. And so as we prepare our hearts for the Lord's Supper, even at home, if you can grab your elements, even now you can go get your elements where you can join us. We come before him with a broken and contrite heart. Today we're going to see that joy actually begins in a very unusual place. It starts with our guilt and our sin and a repentance, turning to his grace, which ultimately brings joy. And so our text, a portion of the text for today is 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3 through 7. We can read this together. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, I'll continue on, more precious than gold, that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Praise be to God. Let's pray together right now. I want to just ask you, right where you are, even at home, right in this room, that you would come before him, confessing sin before him. Maybe it's been a sin of fear. Maybe it's been the sin of not trusting him. Maybe it's in your relationships. Maybe it's a pattern or habitual sin. Let us bring that to him now. Lord, we are a people in need of your grace, and together we repent as your people. We repent for our nation. We turn to you and give our hearts to you anew so that you might restore the land. You bring revival and renewal even today into our hearts. That our individual renewal would bring about corporate renewal. Corporate renewal would result in revival among us. And Lord God, we thank you for the gift of Jesus. We pray that even now you would restore in us as we pray and listen and reach out to you, call out to you as we pray the prayer of David. A broken and contrite heart you will not despise. Restore to us the joy of our salvation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
to the book of 1 Peter. Let's do that.
In
as we watch
of the time
this.
When our nation seems more divided than it's ever been, we knew it would be a time for us as believers to step up and to live radically different lives with love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. It's the fruit of the Spirit. Against such things, there is no law. As we live this out and people see that we are different than the rest of the world, we point the way to Him. When we live with the fruit of the Spirit being expressed in our lives.
Yes, again, go ahead and turn to 1 Peter chapter 1. Hey, I want to ask you the question as we begin. What do you need more than anything in your life right now? Now, that's a loaded question. Probably have to think on it as I have this week. What do you need, not want, what do you need right now more than anything in life? Wisdom, okay, yes. Hope. A lot of us, we might say peace. How about joy? Anybody need a little more joy in this world that we live in? Joy would not be the word that we'd probably use to describe the past 6 months. Probably not. I haven't heard it attached to the pandemic a whole lot. And yet, joy is our calling card. Joy is a mark of the fruit of the Spirit. And we're so excited to be offering resources to you and for all the hundreds and for some time to come, maybe henceforth and forever. More people are going to be watching us now online. We had two people who came to Christ earlier today online. We praise God for that. But we have sermon resources for you. In fact, you can see it here scanning this code. Okay, it's a QR code that's going to help you. It actually goes to now questions. It goes to resources that you can have on the sermon so that you can apply it to your life throughout the week. We'll leave it up there for a sec. But this will help you. A lot of our groups are doing this. We have groups that are based on the sermons. Lots of great resources there and helps for you, even in your, even a devotional guide. So you go online there later if you didn't quite catch that, and you'll find all of our resources there on our website. So our entire series here, of course, as we seek to apply the Word of God, is based on Galatians 5, verses 22 and 23. And this is the umbrella verse, two verses. We're memorizing, okay, along with other verses we're memorizing every week. And let's do this. Let's say it together, okay? Here it is. Let's say it together. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. Did I throw us off there? Let's continue to memorize all of the fruit of the Spirit as our children are doing, singing songs about it. We said last week that love is the first and greatest, right? For a reason. Love is the Mount Everest for us all, the climb for every believer to love like Jesus. We said that love like Jesus doesn't make sense. Love like Jesus doesn't work. It's not pragmatic. Love like Jesus doesn't pay off. It's not a law of reciprocity. Love like Jesus, we said, never ends. Love never ends. And we've been called to this kind of love. And this is the kind of love that changes the world. We said, we asked the question, do you really believe in love in relationships? Do we really believe that a gentle answer turns away wrath? Do we really believe that grace actually wins the day in an argument, a confrontation that people have? While some who claim to be followers of Jesus, or even Christians in our day, and I'm seeing it from Christian leaders as well, some are mimicking the attitude of our culture right now. You know, whether it's supporting partisan candidates or fueling anger online, the future belongs to churches who don't do that. The future belongs to churches and believers who offer an alternative to the culture itself. That's what the culture needs. It's an alternative, and that's who we are. We show a different way. This is what Jesus has called us to. Now is the time for us as his followers to stand up and say, you know, the answer to hate is not more hate. It's love. In fact, it's an enemy love that Jesus embodied and he's called us to live out. And this alternative life is a life filled with the Spirit of God. It's allowing His Spirit. So love like Jesus will result in overflowing joy in our lives. Now, each week we've chosen a fruit that we can remember when you see it, when you eat it, when you watch it, even, you know, some weeks or years from now, perhaps, you'll be reminded. Our children are learning this as well. The fruit that we're attaching to joy, literal fruit, is orange. I mean, oranges are kind of joyful, right? Who doesn't like orange or orange juice? And what would happen if I were to break this open right now, right? It would splash all over the place, wouldn't it? It would get everywhere because that's what joy does. Joy splashes out. Joy just can't be contained. Joy is contagious. And so our premise is that when God changes our hearts, when we receive grace, we then grow in grace. And this whole series, as we talk about the fruit of the Spirit, it's growing in grace and allowing the Spirit to then produce this fruit within us, actual fruit that God does in us. So here's the big question today that I think we all would want to answer. How can I be more joyful? How can I truly be joyful? It's not just wishful thinking. How can I be joyful? And immediately, we do this at Christmas time. We talk a lot about joy. We think happiness, right? Joy and happiness as if they're synonyms. However, we know as Christians that that's not the case. We're going to talk about that. Happiness comes from the word hap. It's a Latin word that means chance. So we talk about happenstance or happiness, you get the idea, is based on circumstance, based around my health, how things are going in my life, my relationships, temporary pleasures in my life. In contrast, joy is not dependent upon anything that's happening. Now, as we'll see today, it is based on something that has happened, but it's not based on anything going on in my life. And I know that many people who are watching me right now are here, not because they can't be, because of the pandemic. They're ill and can't be here. I've talked to so many of our members who right now can't get out of the house for various reasons. And so Paul says, this is why Paul says in Philippians 4, verse 4, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. And this is what's amazing about this verse. This is a command. Think about that. This is an imperative command. Rejoice, Paul says. The word of God says. God says to us, rejoice. Strange command, isn't it? I mean, it's not like, don't murder. Okay, I'm going to try not to murder anyone, right? Don't lie. Okay, not going to lie. Don't commit adultery. Rejoice. Rejoice. Be joyful. And Paul is in prison when he's writing this, which is why he can say, always. And here's what I thought about. We don't confront people on this. Like we might other sins, right? We call out sin and other believers, other friends, and I mean, brothers and sisters in the Lord. And yet, we don't call this one out. And you're probably like me. You know Christians who are not joyful. I mean, you probably know people. Sometimes you see them. You know, I'll see someone and go, okay, here you come. What are you mad about this week? Right? You know anybody like that? Okay, what's wrong in your life today? Okay, because I know that's what's coming. You know people like that? You know Christians like that? Begs the question, am I like that? Are you a joyful person? Today we're going to see that we truly can be joyful always. Now, I know if you're thinking with me, you're going, well, Jeff, come on. Some people, they have a reason not to be joyful. You know, you're the one talking about grace. You're the one talking about caring for people, you know, with depression and anxiety. There's so much on us right now. I mean, you're the one. Yes, we're to be loving. But what we do is we say, you know, my coworkers make me crazy. I'm not real happy right now. My children, we're in a really tough time with my kids or this one. Or I have an illness. Or like others in our church family in recent days, I could go on and on. I've lost a loved one. I've lost my job. You're telling me to be joyful? How can I be joyful with all that's going on in my life? I'm glad you've asked that question. Because God tells us how. He tells us in His word how. He says we can rejoice always. The Bible says that there is one called the Holy Spirit, who when we receive Christ, He comes into our lives and He actually makes us more loving, more joyful. More patient, more kind, peaceful. He makes us better. He makes us faithful. He gives us self-control that we didn't have. So let's talk about this and apply it to our lives. Again, 1 Peter now, verses 1. We're going to go 3 through 9. We're going to continue on through the latter part of this section here of Scripture. This is a great passage of Scripture. 1 Peter 1. Now, there's a distinction. And I'll, again, setting this up. There's a distinction between joy and happiness. And let me just clarify that. Most of us, if you're a Christian, you kind of understand this. If you're watching me now, and you, or even here, you may not be a believer. You're thinking through this. You're still kind of seeking, trying to understand the way of Jesus. It kind of begged the question for me this week, can non-Christians, people who don't know Christ, can they really know the difference, distinction between joy and happiness? I would say yes and no. But it's all about the source of your joy, as we'll find out today. In his book, The Road to Character, David Brooks writes about what he talks about, a joy that's not based on circumstance. He talks about this distinction between what he calls happiness and moral joy. Okay, now listen to this. He writes, it's a byproduct experienced by people who are aiming for something else. He calls it moral joy. He says there's a joy that those who have their values in deep harmony with their behavior, okay, experience. So that's integrity. When what you believe and want to be true about you is actually how you live. He says there's a peace. He says this, a quiet sense of gratitude and tranquility, which is a byproduct of successful moral struggle, he says. So it's something you have to strive for. You work hard towards. Now, I love a lot of what David Brooks writes. He's just speaking like any good religious person right here. And he says in his latest book, he says that he is he describes himself as nominally Jewish. He's married a Christian gal, and a really confused Christian is what he says he is. He's still sorting through it. We can continue to pray for him. Brilliant mind. But what I want you to see today is that Christian joy is indeed very different from happiness and very different from moral joy. In fact, Christian joy, here it is rooted in our salvation. This is the key point today. Christian joy is the result of one's salvation, and true joy is a fruit of the Spirit of God in us. So if you're not a believer, this is where I say yes and no, you might understand there might be a distinction of some kind of joy that I can hang on to that's not based on circumstance. I would argue, no, probably not. It's the source of your joy. Pastor Alistair Begg points out that joy, as I noted, begins in a very unusual place, unexpected place. He's the one who says joy actually begins with guilt. We don't like to talk about guilt. We don't like to talk about or use words like misery to describe our sinful state, and yet that's exactly what it is. To try to find joy, okay, apart from Christ in all things that are in the world. Circumstantial happiness leads to misery. Because there's no stopping it. And just when you think you've grasped it, you realize that thing is taken away and you're destroyed again. That is a miserable way to live. And many of you, again, watching online are living that kind of life. So listen in. Because here's the progression. Guilt moves to grace. It moves us to grace. Grace leads to gratitude, and gratitude leads to joy. So let's start our journey to joy in this most unexpected place. Let's start with guilt, right? Again, this is a word we don't like to talk about. We all wrestle with it. Why? Because we're all guilty. That's why. And the Bible tells us that there's this mercy that has come to us. God has come to us and given us what we don't deserve. It's a mercy that comes our way. But before we get to the solution, let's look at the problem. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, there it is, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Now, why this great mercy? Because all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Our sin, our guilt, as a result of our sin, we have a problem. Notice that our sin is universal and it's terminal. Romans 6:23 says the wages of sin is death. But the free gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. That's where we're heading here, right? So the answer to your guilt, this feeling of guilt, is not to simply work harder and get better so you might achieve some moral joy. Instead, here's what happens. See, over time, those who live that way become even more miserable. Notice this. God has caused this thing to happen. God has, look at what he says, caused us. Notice he has done this thing, this living hope, through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. He says nothing about working harder, getting better, pulling yourself up by your own bootstraps, being more religious. He says God has done this thing. It's based on something that's already happened. If you, listen, if we're not aware of our sin, that's one of the crazy things about being lost. You don't know you're lost. And yet the guilt that we have and this despair that we experience should point us to God's love for us. Look at verse 4. To an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading. Words to use to describe it. Kept in heaven for you. Who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. He's speaking what theologians talk about between the already and the not yet. There's a realized eschatology to come, but it starts with guilt and it leads to grace. Okay? This salvation, he says, is sheer grace. Our new position, I love the acronym, God's riches at Christ's expense. Joy comes as we constantly get back to the rock of our salvation. So whatever you're going through, everything goes back to that. It's not manufactured by us, by positive thinking or better thoughts or harder work. It's by believing more deeply what Christ has already done for us, if you have received his grace. That's the big question today. And so as we've talked about the orange, for instance, last week, the watermelon, if I were to take a seed out of this orange and just let it sit a while, it dries up and it's dead. It needs a source, watch this, from outside of itself to bring it back to life again. It's not within us. It comes from outside of us, the seed planted in the ground, soil, water, all that needs to come, ultimately an orange tree that bears oranges. Dead, dry seed now produces an orange. If I opened it up, it would splash all over the place with more seeds in it. Only God can do that. And only God can bring our dead lives and hearts back to life again. Look at verse 4. Where it says this imperishable, undefiled, and unfading thing that's kept for us in heaven. It's the grace that comes back to us, brings us back to Jesus that he's extended to us. We need a force, again, outside of ourselves. Look at verse 6. Let's go there. Verse 6. In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials. Now the language here is you're going to be, and for different reasons, you're going to be struggling and going through various trials. Look at this. We rejoice, which is, to experience intense joy. The re on rejoice is actually intensive. So I guess superlative. We rejoice with big joy, again and more joy. This joy we experience has its source in God. It's like giving thanks. Think about it this way. Thanksgiving, not too far away. Always at Thanksgiving, I wonder, atheists celebrating Thanksgiving. Who are they thanking? You see, our joy is that way. Joy is a response to the grace that's extended us. We know who to thank. We know who to praise. And so rejoicing, it's why we say we rejoice in the Lord. We bring joy to him. So our guilt leads to grace, which leads to gratitude for the grace that we have received that has removed our guilt. But wait, we rejoice even in our grief and our trials. I've walked with so many people, again, through this season, through horrific trials. We've had folks who have had family members die. We've had members die of COVID-19. We've had people die because of other things during this season. It's just been horrific. Notice that he says there's purpose in the suffering. I've been so amazed and so encouraged by families who walk through such grief and loss, and yet there's joy. Real joy. Because, Jeff, I know that I have my salvation firm in Christ, and that's all that matters in life. Look at verse 8. Though you've not seen him, watch the progression. You love him. Though you do not now see him, now you believe in him and rejoice with joy. There it is. There's that superlative language. What? Rejoice with joy and more joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. You see that progression there. Our guilt leads to grace, should. Repentance and grace received by faith. Grace leads to gratitude. Gratitude, here it is, leads to joy. So here's the equation. Guilt plus grace plus gratitude equals joy. Joy is rooted in the gospel. There was a time in Luke 10, you might know this story, where the disciples are sent off on mission. They come back to debrief with Jesus, and they're going, man, even demons respond to us in your name. And Jesus says, basically, meh. Now, that's my translation, kind of the remix translation. Meh. I tell you what to rejoice in. Rejoice that your names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Rejoice in that. Even in the great things that are happening in life, the bad things, yes, we've talked about. Jesus says, even in those things, listen, rejoice. When's the last time you rejoice that your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life? That's the source of our joy. No wonder you're not so joyful. Every day, every minute, we come back to the gospel. Jesus says, rejoice in that. And friends, if you're listening to me right now and you don't know if your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, that's why God has you listening to me right now. Hearing his word so that you would receive. Notice in verse 8, he says, you believe in him. You believe in him. You might say, well, help me with my unbelief. I struggle. Well, this is the Christian life. Believing in what Christ has done for us. Do you believe? What is the source of your joy? What is the only comfort in your life? Because there's going to be one, ultimately. What is the only comfort in your life? Happiness comes from pleasant circumstances, we've noted. Joy does not. You can rejoice always. Always. I want you to hear this. I was challenged by this week. The Heidelberg Catechism, which was a series of questions, 129 questions, written during the Reformation. It was written so that believers could answer the questions and have a better grip on what we believe and how to live out the Christian life. Okay, so as Baptists, we don't do catechisms, but hang on. Before we judge it too strongly, I want you to listen to this. Listen to the first question of 129. What is your only comfort in life and death? Here's the answer. That I am not my own, but belong with body and soul, both in life and in death, to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. He has fully paid for all my sins with his precious blood and has set me free from all the power of the devil. He also preserves me in such a way that without the will of my heavenly Father, not a hair can fall from my head. Indeed, all things work together for my salvation. Therefore, kind of long answer, by his Holy Spirit, he also assures me of eternal life and makes me heartily willing and ready also right now, from now on, to live for him. It's an incredible response. Question number two. I won't go through all of them. Just this one. Question number two. What must you know to live and die in the joy of this comfort? Here it is. Three things. First, how great my sin and misery are. Second, how I am set free from all my sins and misery. And thirdly, how I am to thank God for such a deliverance. Wow. This is the Christian life. This is it. Let me ask you, how many joyful people do you know? And are you one of them? It all goes back to what Christ has done for us. And as we wrap up and set our hearts towards the Lord's Supper, three barriers to joy. Okay, the first one, sinful foolishness. Turning to other things in pursuit of worldly happiness. I'm reminded of C.S. Lewis's famous quote here. We are half-hearted creatures fooling around with drink and sex and ambition when infinite joy is offered us. Like an ignorant child who wants to go on making mud pies in the slum because he cannot imagine what is meant by the offer of a holiday at the sea. We're far too easily pleased, he says. When infinite joy is offered us, we don't see it and we don't even want it. That is our problem. We must turn to him. What foolishness is standing in your way in these days? What sin is standing in your way? Confess it. Repent of it. The second barrier is spiritual amnesia. It's forgetting the gospel. It's forgetting what Christ has done for us. It's biblical amnesia. And let me say this, listen. Don't tell me God is silent if your Bible is closed. It's a reminder of what he's done. Why communion? Why the Lord's Supper? Jesus says, remember, remember. Every day, remember your sins are forgiven and forgotten. And again, Alistair Begg points this out. He does a great work on joy here. He says, we deplete our joy by forgetting what we should remember and by remembering what we should forget. Scripture aligns our hearts and our minds to what is true. And then the last thing is temporary happiness. Last barrier, the greatest barrier, I think in our context in North Dallas, is the great thing that stands in the way of joy, gospel-centered joy, is happiness. Good things, really good things at times that aren't God things. Things that are fleeting, things that are going away that aren't deeply satisfying. So we need to attach our joy in real time to whatever we're going through. And many of us like me, you can say, you know, I do it better. I can look back and I can be joyful in what God has done in the past. And you can say, what does that mean for me? I can't quite bring it into real time. Well, it means that you're a growing Christian. That's what it means. It means you're seeking to bring it right there together. We're not saved by joy. Praise God. We're saved by faith and his grace that has come to us in Jesus. This week, I'm challenging us all to live joyful lives. It's what the world needs. It's what your spouse needs. It's what your friends need. It's to you to be joyful. Listen, Satan, the evil one, he hates it when we are joyful through challenging times. Martin Luther, when someone would come to him with some sorrow or struggle, he would say, come let us sing and spite the devil. There's a militant stance that says, I will rejoice always. Again, I will say rejoice. I'm going to live that way this week. Jesus said in John 15:11, these things I have spoken to you that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full. What has he spoken to us? He's spoken his gospel, his love. He says, abide in me, receive my grace, and then respond with gratitude. Friends, listen, confess your guilt, your sin before him. Receive his grace, express your gratitude. Live a life of joy. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you for your word today that reminds us of how good you are. We thank you, Lord, that our worth is not in ourselves or what we have. Our joy is not found in anything but you. And so, Lord, we just respond to your grace, and those who are watching, just with everyone, with your eyes closed and your heads bowed, I want to challenge you, if you're watching right now and you don't have this kind of joy, you can receive his grace right now. Let your guilt, your misery lead you to repentance and to his grace. Let it lead you to a life of gratitude. All of the Christian life is one of repentance and response to what you've done for us. And so, Lord, we love you. We give you our lives, Lord, anew. All of us, we give you our lives. We live in light of the gospel and what you've done for us on the cross. And we worship you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Not in what I own, not in the strength of flesh and bone, but in the costly wounds of love at the cross. My worth is not in skill or fame, in win or lose, in pride or shame, the blood that Christ had flowed on the cross. I rejoice in my Redeemer, greatest treasure, wellspring of my soul. I will trust in him no other, my soul is satisfied.
Sing with us.
As summer flowers we fade and die, faint youth and beauty hurry by, but life eternal calls to us.
Lift your voice.
I rejoice in my Redeemer, greatest treasure, wellspring of my soul. I trust in him no other, my soul is satisfied in him alone.
I rejoice. Satisfied in Christ alone, nothing else, save Jesus. Amen and amen. Be seated.
Amen. Thank you so much, Jamie, Stephen, and church family. Well, now we come to a point. I hope at home, again, you have your elements before you there, and you'll have them. You see those in front of you here in our room. In this room, and you can take it just for a moment. I'll guide you because this is not the normal way that we do this. I'm told that there are also some gluten-free possibilities back in the back that you may need if you want that. But right now, here's what we'll do. We're going to take that top cellophane piece off, okay? Not the whole thing, just the top, if you can pull that off. And then you'll see there the wafer that represents the bread. So we take the bread that represents the body of Christ that has been broken for us. Friend, don't forget, Jesus says to his disciples, until I come again, and I'm coming again, you'll do this together as you gather. And so his words echo forth to us in this place, in your home, right where you are today. This is my body broken for you. Take, eat, and remember.
My Jesus, I love thee. Sing with us.
My Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine. For thee all the follies of sin I resign. My gracious Redeemer, my Savior, art thou. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, tis now.
And now if you'll take your cup there and then peel off the top layer, and as you're preparing at home to join us, be careful with this one. You have then the cup that represents the juice that represents the blood of Christ. You know, we sing how much we love him, and some songs are aspiring songs. I don't know if you're like me. Can you say now, today, singing that you love him now more than you ever have, ever in your life? I'm not sure I can sing that right now. But I know this. He loves me more than he ever has, more than he ever will. His love for me doesn't change, even when mine does. It's the grace of God that's come to us because of the event when his body was broken on the cross and his blood was shed for us. This is where our joy comes from. It becomes our sustenance. It becomes our food. It becomes life, our source of joy. And so his words come to us today, and he says, take and drink. This is my blood shed for you. Remember.
Lift your voice.
Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bids me come to thee, O Lamb. I come broken to be mended. I come wounded to be healed. I come desperate to be rescued. I come empty to be filled. I come guilty to be pardoned by the blood of Christ the Lamb. And I'm praise God, just as I am.
Let's pray together. What a beautiful way to end this service, and even better, to enter into the coming week. You receive us just as we are. Lord, we're so thankful because of the cross. May we preach the gospel to ourselves every day this week, every moment of every day, so that we can live joyful lives that give glory and honor and praise to you, our Savior, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Well, hasn't it been great to worship together and gather again? Well, as ministers, we're always here to pray with you and serve with you, and we also want to answer any questions or help you connect to the church or understand your faith. We'll be right back there in our Next Steps area, right through the back door, so please come back and share with us. We do have social distancing set up to do that, but if you're not quite comfortable with that, we also have the QR code. So again, you could take a picture of that and let us know, and we'll contact you after today. For those who weren't able to worship with us today and enjoy that holy moment of communion with a minister, we've set up a socially distant way to do that, in that today from 5 to 6:30, you can receive the elements from your car and pray with the minister. So if you'd like to come, just enter the Circle Drive from Northwest Highway, and we'll give you directions from there, and hopefully that'll be a very special experience for you. And lastly, as you exit today, don't forget to keep your mask on till you get to your car. Follow the directional signs we've set out. They're very specific to help us social distance and keep safe so we can come back next week and enjoy our time together.
Thank you, Debbie. To worship our living God together is indeed a great joy. It's difficult to find words just how meaningful it has been. One word that Jeff mentioned is God's love for us. I am so desperately in need for that. I know you are too. I know that today you're grateful that God loves you. And because he does, we can truly have joy, and we can stand amazed in the presence of the one who provided us that joy, Jesus Christ. I stand amazed in the presence is the song that we'll conclude our worship with. We're so grateful that you worshiped with us on the broadcast, and those of you of our church membership here. Let's stand together and lift our voices with great joy. I stand amazed in the presence. Sing with me. Together.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene.
God bless you. You're greatly loved. You're dismissed.